And now for our weather segment, although this is about the winter of 1959. In February of that year, a tornado ripped through the heart of the city. We didn't have the weather forecasting technology that we do today, and it came with little warning. There were sirens, but back then, that's not what sirens were for.
It was about 2 a.m., early morning, February 10th, 1959. This is not actual film of the tornado, but this is film of the damage it caused. 21 people were killed, hundreds were injured along its path. It started in the county near the Merrimack River, moved up Manchester Road. There was damage. Heavy rains brought flooding. The tornado kept moving northeast into the city. At Hampton and Oakland, Channel 2's tower came crashing down on an apartment building. It knocked down one of the decorative towers at the arena and put a gaping hole in its roof. It then moved into the heart of the city. At Olive and Boyle, Gaslight Square, St. Louis Cardinal Joe Cunningham was still awake in his apartment.
And then all of a sudden, it's 2 o'clock, and 2:04, the tornado came through our apartment. And I saw the wall crack, paint crack, and that's when I dove back in the bedroom. It scared me. It completely scared me. When we finally got dressed and went down the stairway, you know, there was a lot of rocks and glass and everything there. And when we went out on the street, then we saw it was like an air raid.
Whether they were in its path or not, St. Louisans are likely to remember the 1959 tornado.
Yeah, it's one of my earlier memories. It happens that it took place right on my brother's 16th birthday. It was going to be a big deal. He was going to go down and get his driver's license. My dad was going to take off work early. Wakes up on that morning of February 10th, and they have to tell him, we can't go. All the city is closed.
Dr. Jack Fishman grew up to become a professor of meteorology at St. Louis University.
Anyway, that's what I remember about it as a nine-year-old at that time, yes.
So it's a 2 a.m. middle of winter tornado. Is that unusual?
It's extremely unusual, primarily because when you see the outbreak of severe weather, you need a lot of intense heat to be forming, and you need a really moist atmosphere. In the wintertime in February, it's not that moist, and obviously there's not a whole lot of heat.
Just 2 days before the tornado, the Afternoon Post-Dispatch reported that the Weather Bureau was uncertain about the coming storm. Warm and cold fronts were colliding, and forecasters were predicting that the cold front would dominate, possibly bringing sleet, freezing rain, or snow. But they admitted that forecasting the next 2 days was difficult. The next day, less than 24 hours before the tornado, the warm front was winning. The temperature was climbing into the 60s. Heavy fog shut down the airport. Now, the winter weather was acting more like spring.
Piecing together all this information, the staff prepares a detailed analysis of areas in which violent squall lines, hailstorms, and other dangerous weather conditions are likely to occur, where a tornado may develop.
But no, they were totally caught off guard. We didn't have the technology back in those days to really be able to forecast these severe storms, and especially at such an unusual hour.
From our archives, here's part of an interview with the man who was St. Louis's chief meteorologist in 1959.
It was determined that the tornado actually developed just as it got into the St. Louis area, so the population could not be advised in advance.
This wasn't St. Louis's first or worst tornado. The 1896 cyclone, they called it, killed hundreds of people on both sides of the river. The 1927 tornado hit about 1 o'clock on a Thursday afternoon in September. 5 girls were killed at Central High School. Back then, they knew so little about tornadoes. They were so powerful, so unpredictable, that the U.S. Weather Service actually discouraged the use of the term tornado in its forecasts because it might cause panic. It wasn't until 1948 that two Air Force meteorologists at Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma, Captains Miller and Faubush, accurately predicted a tornado based on atmospheric conditions. It was a first. Their techniques were applied, leading to the ability to issue earlier storm watches and warnings. In 1959, there were still no weather satellites orbiting the Earth, no advanced computer models for forecasting, but they were starting to use radar.
We, at that time, had just installed, shortly before this, one of the first radar used for weather. It was a modified radar that we obtained from the military, and it had been rehabbed so that we could use it for spotting weather.
This is Brummett, Mr. Powell. Tornado about a mile east of the wind pumping station.
Information was spread by telephone and fax machines, and when needed, the warnings went out on radio and TV stations.
We interrupt this newscast to bring you this severe weather forecast issued by the United States Weather Bureau.
Just as big cities were equipped with radar initially for defense purposes, there were also sirens, but they were not for weather warnings. This was the Cold War. Kids in the 1950s didn't do tornado drills. They were doing air raid drills. That was still a bigger concern than severe weather.
Sort of funny, you have to think back to the 1950s and the big Russian scare and everything. And remember, we're only about, 10, 15 years removed from the Second World War. So the use of sirens was going to be used primarily for warning of the Russian missiles to come in.
But immediately after the St. Louis tornado of 1959, 60 years ago, there was talk about using air raid sirens for tornado warnings. But St. Louis's Civil Defense Director, Francis Hardaway, advised Mayor Tucker that that would cause confusion and that the city should stick to using radio and TV for weather warnings. But many said the siren should simply mean take cover.
Families took shelter in the southwest corner of their home.
And some area communities began moving towards using sirens. But as is often the case in this metropolitan area, there were disagreements and delays. And a region-wide coordinated weather warning system using sirens was not implemented until 1967, 8 years after the tornado. That's 60 years. When it comes to technology, that is a long time ago. We now have satellites, Doppler radars, powerful computers. The human element is still important. There is a science and an art to all of this. But for all we have, tornadoes remain one of weather forecasting's toughest challenges.
You can't necessarily say when it's going to touch down or how long it's going to travel or the direction it might travel.
No. I mean, they're trying to deal with hurricanes. That's a bigger animal, and you can follow that for a much larger period of time. And they're getting pretty good at that. But I don't think the tornado forecasting community is quite to that extent. The other challenge is getting the information out to the public, okay? And you don't want to produce warnings and you get criticized for crying wolf too often. And maybe that's the real challenge. We know that the circulation is there. We know that the conditions are right. A lot of times the forecast is right on, but you don't quite get a tornado. You get an upper level funnel cloud.
For Living St. Louis, I'm Jim Kircher.